Live from New York City, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
I don't love you anymore. It's just a simple.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null. Today, we're going to learn how a particular supplementation could help maintain muscle strength during exercise. Well, boy, we can all benefit from that. And that's from the University of Nebraska, published in the peer-reviewed journal of International Society for Sports Nutrition. Also today, I want to share an original commentary. I was up last night from about 3 o'clock because I began to think about all that's wrong with society that we're not paying attention to, and I believe should be far more important than every day 24/7 Trump, Trump, Trump. Now, yes, we should be concerned about what a president does, but we were not concerned, depending upon our political side, left or right, or independent, or myself, a progressive, we weren't concerned about the other. In other words, if someone did something that we supported, like if the Republicans supported Bush or Democrats supported Clinton or Obama, then they overlooked all of the problems that that administration or that person was engaged in, like supporting the wars in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in the invasion of Libya and Syria, the undermining of democratically elected programs in, let's say, Honduras or the Ukraine. And then I mentioned at the beginning of President Trump's, his four-year, hopefully, administration, I said, don't pay attention to Trump as much as you pay attention to the things that got Trump elected. Bring back jobs, re-empower people, give them a living wage, clean up their environment, de-ghettoize America, stop funding the military-industrial complex and giving subsidies to these gigantic industries where they privatize their profits but socialize their losses. Work on what people care about, and then Trump won't get reelected. But no, it's been 24/7 Trump. So I wrote a commentary this morning, and I'm going to share that with you today. Then we're going to go to my guest as a part of our Conversations with Remarkable Minds. I haven't been able to do one in a while for a simple reason. I've been so concerned about how Google and Facebook and Wikipedia and the Wall Street Journal and the New York Times and the Washington Post and CNN and MSNBC and Fox, they're all concerned about what our agenda should be. They're spoon-feeding us misinformation and bias. They're scrubbing, eliminating completely the good work of Chris Hedges, Abby Martin, the people like who are giving us factual information about the state of our economy, the state of our health. Anything by Mercola, scrubbed. You can't find an article by him by Googling it. And yet there have plenty of articles, thousands of articles about why you should take your chemotherapy and why radiation's good for treatment and why vitamins don't work and why GMOs are good and why organic is not. So everywhere we look, there is an open, full-force, deep state takeover of the vehicles that most people get their information from. So I've invited Ray McGovern on today to talk about what they've done to Julian Assange, his condition, the torture, the recent arrest of journalist Max Blumenthal, one of the best independent journalists in America, and how this is a harbinger of the demise of truthful journalism. So that's our show today. But we always begin with the latest on health and healing. And a report that's just out today documents the outcome of a study of men involved in recreational sports who experienced better muscle strength during exercise-induced fatigue and exhibited decreased levels of the amino acid that is the biomarker for collagen degradation, where you start to lose your muscle. And it's 500 milligrams of what is called shilajit, S-H-I-L-A-G-I-T. That's an exudate of the sedentary rocks of the Himalayas and other mountains and is known in Ayurvedic medicine as super vitalizer. once again. And by the way, isn't it interesting? Because everything about Ayurvedic, that's A-Y-U-R-V-I-D-C, medicine used by hundreds of millions of people in India for thousands of years. They completely disregard it, saying it's nothing. There's rubbish, don't use it. They've done the same thing with the traditional Chinese medicine. And that's why I've written articles on Ayurvedic medicine. Read the articles. 55 articles challenging Wikipedia. Every one of those is a completely different and original take. It's still Wikipedia, but I try to show you that if they tell you don't use chiropractic, here are the peer-reviewed journals showing it works. Don't use homeopathy, it doesn't work. Yes, it does. Here's the peer-reviewed literature showing it works. Don't go to a complementary or alternative doctor. They're nut jobs. No, they're not. They could have used traditional medicine and did until they found it didn't work, and then they re-educated themselves and are using natural medicine that is helping with diet and exercise. So you see, every one of my articles is in defense of your right to choose the therapy you want and show you its legitimacy, even by their standards of peer-reviewed literature. In any case, so when it comes to Ayurvedic medicine, here's a study published in the peer-reviewed journal showing that Ayurvedic medicine works and can really help you if you want to be stronger, and you are. And this was a placebo-controlled study. And so that's what it means. So for those who want to be stronger in your exercise, have more endurance, have more stamina, and start to build some muscle and burn some fat, just a 500-milligram dose of, and let me spell it again, S-H-I-L-A-J-I-T. All right? And it's good, and it works. Also, from the University of Florida comes a study about almonds and pistachios. I mentioned pistachios yesterday, but this is a separate study. When you consume them, this is a randomized crossover human feeding study. It really gives you a lot of good bacteria. So according to University of Florida, the modification of the microbiota, micro, M-I-C-R-O, biota, B-I-O-T-A, that's your bacteria, of which there are trillions in your intestine, and this supports the good ones, what they call beneficial, and that in turn helps your overall intestines. Remember, natural fibers and phytochemicals that are released from the skins and the flesh of fruits and vegetables and nuts and seeds and grains and vegetables of all types, starchy and non-starchy, when they reach what is called the proximal colon, such as those present in various nuts, they provide substrates for the maintenance of healthy and diverse microbiota. And the effects of increased consumption of specific nuts, which are rich in fiber and good oils and phytonutrients, that then recolonizes, causes an increase in the growth of good bacteria. And that's important. And that's what this shows in this randomized trial. So at the top of the list are almonds and pistachios to really help you have a good intestine. Also from the University of Georgia, smoking and food additives are linked to hardening of the arteries, which, as we know, is a risk factor for heart disease and death. So having healthy arteries is vital to prevent chronic disease like coronary artery disease. And the hardening of the arteries, or what is called arterial stiffness, is a very big risk factor for heart disease, and you can't feel it. And it even increases our risk of death. And most people have undiagnosed, unrecognized atherosclerosis and arteriosclerosis. So that's why once a year you should really get a full spectrum cardiovascular assessment. And the older you are, the more you need this. This was published in the American Journal of Hypertension under an article about how lifestyle factors can contribute to hardening of the arteries. And of course, you guessed it, the more of the common diet items like fast foods, loaded with junk, sugar, and artificial sweeteners and plasticizers. And when you smoke on top of that, let's face it, most people who smoke are not the people most likely to be selecting healthy, organic, high-fiber foods. It's just an oxymoron. It's contraindicated. So when you're smoking and drinking, you just don't suddenly start to go out and be a vegan. It's just not what happens. I grew up in a family where all of my immediate family and my aunts and uncles smoked, and they drank, and they smoked, and they ate a lot of unhealthy food, and they were overweight. One was obese, only one that I remember. But they didn't think anything they were doing was wrong, because everyone else did it, and they were just going along. I remember once, everyone was sitting around the table, and every Sunday in my family, like a lot of people, you got together and the adults played cards like canasta or bridge, and they gave a quarter or 50 cents to the kids to go to a movie. But we all had, the kids ate in the kitchen, and the adults ate at the main table. And so I went in, and I was in high school, and so I just asked, why is it that we don't have any understanding that what we're eating and what we're doing with our lifestyle is not healthy? And there's just this silence. And then one of my aunts said, well, Gary, if what we were doing was not healthy, our doctor would tell us. And our doctor does exactly what we're doing. And my aunt was correct. All the doctors smoke and drank and ate, big meat diets, dairy, white bread. A lunch where I grew up, I remember it. Every day was the same lunch. Once in a while they'd have, take a Campbell's soup and it would be chicken noodle soup. But almost always it was tomato soup, and not fresh-made tomatoes. Tomato soup out of a can and a grilled cheese sandwich. That means white bread that they put butter on, put some dairy cheese on there, and grill it. And we got used to that, and a glass of milk. Well, no wonder we walked around constantly dripping of the nose and gaseous. It was because of the allergic reactions. But they thought it was normal. No one that I knew would have thought that giving what they were giving was causing the illnesses. We thought illnesses were a normal part of aging. So if you were 40, it was normal to have diabetes and be overweight. Completely normal. But it wasn't. It wasn't normal. It was a conditioned response to a collective indoctrination. So think about that. In any case, from the Center for Human Reproduction in New York, published in the peer-reviewed journal Endocrine, DHEA, that's a very important supplement, and almost everyone's deficient in that later in life, that's associated with improved sexual function in women. That's correct. According to the center, they revealed that improvements in sexual function among older premenopausal women was supplemented with the hormone DHEA. So that's a big deal, because a lot of women end up with lower levels of androgen hormones. So in the process of treating thousands of so-called infertile women, they noticed that many spontaneously reported improvements in libido and sexual desire, and sometimes even pain status, leading to the paradoxical situation of women refusing to discontinue DHEA supplementation once they conceived. So when you review the literature, they could not find the effectiveness of DHEA on female sexuality in older premenopausal women. But I can tell you, having done one of America's longest and most detailed studies, clinical studies, about 12 years ago, where 500 women who were menopausal and some were postmenopausal were put on the same identical lifestyle and behavior modification protocol. And what we found was that when we went to a plant-based, organic, healthy diet, exercising twice a day for 45 minutes, taking certain supplementation, including DHEA at 25 milligrams, and vitamin E at 400 units, and coenzyme Q10 at 300 milligrams, and B-complex at 50 milligrams, and vitamin B12 and folic acid at 1 milligram methylated, and the juicing throughout the day with fresh natural juices, including green juices, that we reverse menopause in 8 women, meaning that 8 women, the oldest being 8 years, meaning it was 8 years since her last period, they reverted back. Now, think of what reverted. Hair came back in where they were thinning or balding, natural and thick and lustreful, with natural color. Oh, yeah, I never will forget this woman named Celia. She came in, and she came over to me, and she's, look very closely. And she pulled back her hair, and she's, look at my roots. My roots are all auburn. I haven't had auburn hair. I've had white hair for 25 years, she said. And she said, now my hair's coming back. Other people said, look at our fingernails. They're pink and hard instead of being cracked and flecked and weak and brittle. People's skin tightened up. Their energy increased. Their libido increased tremendously. The vaginal walls became flush and moist again instead of chafing. Before, just having normal intimate relationships with their partners was painful, and they would chafe and bleed and have infections. Not now. Sleeping through a night and waking up refreshed and energized in the morning. So, and I was, that published in a peer journal, and I presented for a scientific congress in Chicago on that one. So yeah, DHEA was a part of that. And that's important because that's the mother hormone from which other hormones are actually created. So arousal, increase in desire, improved tremendously. Exercise, burning of body fat, improvement of mood. So do it right, a lot of good stuff. And finally, tart, sweet, and full of antioxidants. 5 reasons to add the hawthorn berries to your diet. Now, I take a hawthorn every single day. Hawthorn berries are tiny fruits that have a storied history. Their use as a remedy for various diseases is well documented in ancient medical records. And the Greek physician wrote in the 1st century AD, Dioscorides, that these berries are effective in increasing blood flow to the heart. Meanwhile, Chinese healers have been using it. Now, it's best to get the concentrate. That's the way you get it. And it improves digestion. And today, it's important in helping build up your immune system. So it's worth noting the term hawthorn can refer to any of the trees and shrubs that belong to the genus Crataegus, C-R-A-T-A-E-G-U-S. And these are native to North America. And the most well-known of the numerous hawthorn and the smooth hawthorn, which is what is used as hedge plants. But just one more thing that we should consider, and the hawthorn berries are rich in polyphenols, potent antioxidants. So eating hawthorn berries and other antioxidants-rich foods can help protect the body from the effects of oxidative stress. This was all published in the peer-reviewed journal Nutrients, and it can help regulate blood sugar, help prevent heart failure, boost your immunity. Yeah. And by the way, resveratrol prevents cognitive deficits in experimental vascular dementia. This was from the Kakali University in Turkey, published in Physiology and Behaviors. Just simply resveratrol, R-E-S-V-E-R-A-T-R-O-L. That's what you get from grapes and red wine or a supplement. It's really good for helping get better circulation into the brain. And it's good for helping the brain. And it also helps the heart. It has anti-inflammatory effects, neuroprotective effects. That's the latest on health and healing. I'm Gary Null. We're going to take a break and come right back with a special commentary. Please stay with us.
Never matter, girl could make me feel the way that you do. You're all right.
I'm Gary Null. Nice to have you with us. I was just given a heads up that many of the people at the retreat would like to, or not the retreat, the anti-aging, would like to come on the air and tell their own story rather than me telling it for them. That's terrific. So tomorrow I'm going to set aside a half hour from people who are 95, 90, 88, 72, to talk about what's changed in the first half of this study. We're now starting our second half, and then we have a follow-up four-week period at the end of that. Blood chemistry is taken, dozens of measurements taken for objective information. We've seen some remarkable, I mean, absolutely remarkable changes. Stuff that even right now, I can tell you, you'll never see in any hospital or medical office in America where we're remineralizing bones. And we had the actual measurements that we have right now and ongoing. People dropping 5% of their body fat, that's a huge amount to drop in just a month. Tightening up, people suddenly having abs they didn't have, but pot belly's gone. Clearer thinking. And one of the people we did, I've kept one person out of the study, but following the same protocols, and in stage dementia, I mean, near death, completely incoherent. And that person smiling and laughing were before they were screaming, and eye contact and actually creating words and sentences. And the daughter who is with this mother said that this is just like a miracle. This is just the first stage, and we'll see over the next 60 days how much more improvement that goes, because think of all the people that could help. So that'll be tomorrow. So then you'll hear from them directly. Right now I want to share something. I believe Ray McGovern's online. I want him to hear this as well, because I'm concerned, deeply concerned, that we're not thinking deeply enough. We're allowing ourselves to be distracted with trivia. We're not paying attention to what is important. We've given power to sociopaths. We've assumed that people in authority are smarter or better than us, so let them make our decisions. We do not have people who have a spiritual and moral and humanistic value actually working on behalf of all of us, rather we have engaged in identity politics. We have people fighting people who shouldn't be fighting each other, but trying to understand and communicate. So I'm titling this, "The American Empire is Bankrupt and Our Elite are Out Fishing." The progressive website Common Dreams printed an article this week entitled, "What is the Fed Not Telling Us? Fears of Economic Instability After Central Bank Intervention Spikes." The most important statement is the last sentence, quoting Northam Traders Svev Heinrich, quote, "A financial system that requires over $100 billion of liquidity injections every day, temporarily or permanent or otherwise, has a major issue," end quote. Now, it's doubtful that most Americans would understand that the Federal Reserve is flooding the financial market with $100 billion every 24 hours. Yet, you would never hear this reported on the major news networks. Nowhere. Instead, we hear incessant reporting about Trump's impeachment every day, all day. What is missing are the dire warnings that we may be approaching another 2008 economic meltdown and worse. But that is not the only thing the major media is failing to report. There have been multiple studies released this week warning us about climate change, the release of methane gas from millions of square miles in the Arctic region is higher than previously expected. This is the most massive release of methane on a scale never observed before in human history. This could also suddenly change all of the earlier climate metrics about global warming and challenge our very survival on the planet. To give you an example, we're saying we should not exceed 2% increase in, or 2 degrees Celsius increase. We're already at 1.6. And if this methane is released in giant burps, then that could easily exceed, in a matter of months, 2 degrees Celsius, and that changes everything about how food could be grown on the planet and would start severe crisis. Look right now, today. In the last 48 hours, virtually everyone in this audience has become aware that there are major fires, at least 13 major fires, all throughout California. Many people having to move out of their apartments and homes in Los Angeles. And then the wine area, beautiful area, bucolic area, at the northern part of the state, that now is burning. One of the oldest 150-year-old wineries completely destroyed. People who thought they would be able to live a quality of life now have no home at all. But where were the plans to help this be prevented? Where was there an honest, open discussion by the governor and the media that California is no longer sustainable and that maybe it would be a good idea to look for places that were more sustainable and help those people make those moves over a reasonable period of time? Because didn't we observe the same outcry last year? Why didn't we do anything when thousands of homes were destroyed and insurance is not covering them, where people have to go with energy blackouts for as much as 8 hours or longer or 2 days now to over a million people? Something is wrong with our infrastructure, and something is wrong with the foundational beliefs that we can live anywhere we want, use all the resources we want, and not pay a price. That is an issue that we're not discussing nor facing. We're only reeling and lurching from one crisis to another, from a hurricane in one place and a tsunami in another place, from the hottest possible days in dry earth and killing of thousands of animals that is occurring in Australia and New Zealand today, to where it's flooding in Japan and other countries, all across the world. One crisis after another, nothing, absolutely nothing being done about it. But we're not even talking about it. It's out of the news. When was the last time you saw any newspaper or media say, let's look at the aftermath of a major hurricane, Category 6, the first ever recorded, 224 miles, outward band sustainable winds, creeping at 1 mile an hour, that simply flattened everything, every house, every building on Grand Bahamas Island and the 700 islands that are also part of that. Where are those people supposed to go? What food are they supposed to eat? Where's the water coming from? Where are they supposed to sleep? It's not in the news cycle. It's out of conscious. It's no longer important. Nor are we reading on the front page news or hearing from our pundits any mention of a Scientific America article last week on October 17th. The article written by University of California Berkeley professor Joel Moskowitz, quote, "We have no reason to believe 5G is safe," end quote, identifies the serious health risks posed by the rollout of 5G technology. Thousands of scientists internationally have signed a letter to governments warning that 5G is a disaster and possibly the single worst health threat in world history, because none of us can escape it. With 20,000 plus satellites beaming down the signals everywhere on the planet, you're going to be impacted by this electromagnetic pulsing, and this 10,000 peer-reviewed studies proving that 5G can lead us into an era of untold injury to human life and the environment, and environmental sensitivity to these impulses, and how it disrupts chromosomes and brain tissue and can cause cancers and heart disease. None of that, not a single word of that, is anywhere in the American media, nor on any legislator in Washington's talking points to call hearings to see what they could do to stop this. Nothing. But that's not important. Nor are we hearing from the media any word about the recent Stanford University report published in the Journal of Energy and Environmental Science, suggesting that carbon capture technologies may potentially cause more harm than good. Consequently, all of our global efforts to reverse carbon dioxide release trends through technological carbon capture has uncertain proof it will work. Quoting Professor Mark Jacobson at Stanford, the article reports, quote, "Even if you have 100% capture from the capture equipment, it is still worse from a social cost perspective than replacing a coal or gas plant with a wind farm because carbon capture never reduces air pollution and always has a capture equipment cost. Wind replacing fossil fuels always reduces air pollution and never has a capture equipment cost, end quote. So we've been looking at the problem of global warming and capturing the carbon dioxide before it gets into the atmosphere and warms the atmosphere even more. We've been looking at it from the wrong perspective. So this changes. This is a complete paradigm shift. So this means the following, that even if we planted hundreds of billions of trees, it would not stop global warming. What we have to do then is we actually have to stop polluting. We have to stop by a measure of 6 times, 600% difference in our lifestyle. That means that we, becoming a vegan, I'm a vegan, and buy locally and organic, and let's say 3 of my friends are vegans, but they don't care about anything else in their life. They still travel, and they have air conditioners and heating going without thoughts of what it's doing to the environment. And they want a bigger house, or they're buying extra clothes. So then being a vegan does not offset the other factors. So we're really not doing anything when we don't all do something together. Individuals can do something for themselves, and they should. But unless we have a mass of people do it, at least 5 to 6% of the people do anything on the environment, it's not going to make a difference. Because all it takes is the other group not to do anything. So then you have a zero-sum impact. So you're not helping. You're actually hurting. So tokenism doesn't work. So the idea that you're doing a few things but not everything, it doesn't work. And that's what this is showing. So all the efforts of the younger people to become aware first, they got to be educated and become aware. That's why we sent 13 articles to Greta Thunberg to educate her. We sent 5 documentaries we produced to her as well. We sent her 3 major books, the largest book thus far written on what we can do individually, which is not even out on the market yet. It's my newest book. It's 700 pages on saving the planet. All that was sent to her. But then she has to decide what to send to others. She's 16 years old, so she's not making these choices. The people around her are, and they're involved in carbon capture profiteering. We've proved that. We've given you their background, as is Al Gore. So now this man is saying, all that effort on carbon capture, you're going in the wrong direction, because carbon capture does not stop pollution. It doesn't stop global warming. It merely gives an economic incentive to one person to say, I can continue polluting because I'm paying this carbon capture tax to X company or country. So we're going ass backwards on everything. But that's just one example. Also, last year, the U.S. increased its carbon dioxide footprint by 2.3%. So we're increasing our pollution by carbon dioxide, not decreasing, because every American wants a better standard of living, more of everything. Well, when you want more of everything, then who's to say no? We have to bring it back, minimalize. We're not doing that, especially with the increase furthering Trump's orgy of deregulations. But again, the media is not telling us anything about this. Again, this week, constitutional attorney and scholar John Whitehead at the Rutherford Institute shared his insights how the majority of Americans and our legislators are living in a state of delusion. He writes, quote, the hidden messages being drummed into the people's subconscious include no independent thought, conform, submit, stay asleep, buy, watch television, no imagination, and do not ever question authority, end quote. Whitehead defines the new American police state, what Slovenian philosopher Slavoj Zizek calls the, quote, dictatorship of democracy, the visible order which sustains your apparent freedom, end quote. He later references a critical Princeton and Northwestern University study that concluded, quote, the United States does not represent the majority of American citizens. Instead, the study found that the government is ruled by the rich and powerful, or the so-called economic elites. Moreover, the researchers concluded that policies enacted by this government elite nearly always favor special interest groups and lobbying groups. In other words, we are being ruled by an oligarchy disguised as a democracy and arguably on our way towards fascism, a form of government where private corporate interests rule. Money calls the shots and the people are seen as mere subjects to be controlled. In addition, our media rarely makes any truthful mentions of the epidemic of diseases that can be attributed to the standard of our American lifestyle. These illnesses, including cardiovascular disease, diabetes, cancers, obesity, children's mental disorders, etc., are preventable. But that would require our media being honest about the science and report truthfully to Americans. Do you see that on Wikipedia? Do you see that on Google, on Facebook? No. In fact, they scrub, censor the very people that you want to hear in conversations with remarkable minds. Chris Hedges, Abby Martin, Professor Henry Giroux, and at least 1,000 other people I've interviewed. But now those people have become invisible, marginalized. They have been excluded from even being on search engines. So if you want to hear something from Chris Hedges, you can't find it. Because we weren't paying attention as a society when they decided who you could and could not listen to, watch, read, or understand from. Nor is there any reporting about the day-to-day plight and challenges of over half of the American population, approximately 170 million citizens. This includes 16 million children who go to bed hungry every night because they don't have enough food, they're food insecure, and 2.5 million school children who leave school each day and have no home to go to. Nor is there any honest discussion or debate about the media's airwaves being militarized. Yes, they're weaponizing the media. MSNBC, Rachel Maddow, Fox, all the media has been weaponized to engage in fights amongst each other. What about local law enforcement being weaponized? What about our government's role in orchestrating 51 regime changes and coups since the end of the Second World War in order in other nations to support despotic, fascist, and totalitarian regimes such as Saudi Arabia, Ukraine, Brazil, and Honduras? Anyone held accountable? Anyone? Anyone at the CIA? Anyone at the National Security Agency? Anyone in the military defense system? Not a single person. How about anyone in the White House, the policymakers who allowed this to happen? How about their Joint Chiefs of Staff? How about those talking heads on television that tell us we should be afraid and have to increase our military spending? Not a single one has been held accountable. Consequently, the U.S. has become a nation filled with hubris, indifference, and life fatigue. We keep ourselves chronically distracted. We fail to hold the oligarchs who are responsible for the widespread inequality and the destruction of the country's social fabric accountable. Rather, they're worsening our culture through equity partnerships, hedge funds, and outsourcing jobs for the past 40 years, and none of them have been held accountable. They're praised for their wealth and ostentatious lifestyles. The socioeconomic engineers, the global economy, have put the world in its current dire predicament, where millions no longer have access to drinking water, and their lives are further threatened by the oligarchical destruction of natural resources or the privatization of those resources. It is as if the ruling elite and corporations are protected by an alliance of foundations and think tanks, such as the Council on Foreign Relations, the Business Roundtable, and of course the World Bank and International Monetary Fund. And the mainstream media, controlled by the oligarch class and special corporate interests, dutifully parrot their master's talking points without seeing the irony that they have been fully captured and serve as the propagandists for the elite. Ergo, nothing changes. It's a great deal to understand how easy it is for you to be rewarded, protected, and even made whole again if you're in the financial industry, but not if you're the average person. You're relegated now, if you're a student with debt, to the potential of debt peonage. We will not see these people made well or whole again. Because we could forgive the student debt, that would be the right and humanistic thing to do, but the same corporate-controlled legislators who forgave 100% of Wall Street's debt through TARP and other handouts don't want to give any handouts to the students. And by the way, finally, if you think that we're okay, the national debt is $23 trillion, with a total U.S. debt of $74 trillion. The state debt is $1.2 trillion, with $6.8 trillion in unfunded pension liabilities. The local debt is $1.2 trillion. Social Security liabilities, $20 trillion. Medicare liabilities, $31 trillion. U.S. unfunded liabilities, $126.5 trillion. $6.9 trillion of the debt is held by foreign nations. Mortgage debt is $15.8 trillion. Student debt is $1.6 trillion. Credit card debt is $1.1 trillion. $324 trillion if you include corporate debt. And yet someone is saying, it's good out there in the economy. Yeah, if you're spending $324 trillion and you have nothing but a fiat currency to back it up. But that means we are completely, totally bankrupt. Tomorrow, more on that. Now let's go to our guest who's standing by. Thank you very much for your patience and standing by, Ray McGovern.
Thank you for having me.
And also, before we get into our discussion, is there anything, Ray, and by the way, Ray is an outstanding person in the field of honestly and objectively evaluating the social systems through which we live. He was with the Army Intelligence, and he was in the CIA as an analyst for 27 years under seven presidential administrations from Kennedy through George H.W. Bush. And he was there with the daily intelligence briefings that would be collected so that the President of the United States would know what was going on in the world. He holds a degree in theology and philosophy from Fordham University, an MA in Russian history, and is a graduate of Harvard Business School, and also has a background in theology from Georgetown University. His website is raymcgovern.com. Please address anything I said that you would like to add to or challenge, and then I'd like for you to go into the background of where we are with Julian Assange's being in a prison for crimes he did not commit.
Well, great. Let me ask first, how much time do we have?
Whatever we don't have now, you'll have an hour tonight on the Progressive Commentary Hour.
Okay, fine. What I would say is that the handwriting is on the wall. You know, that's... That's from the old Babylonian king, Balthazar, whose prophets and henchmen couldn't figure out what it meant. But what it meant was doom. And what we're seeing now are all the handwriting on the wall made by those mysterious fingers. And you have elucidated the main ones, that is, the ones that we who have children and grandchildren should be worried about. Should be actually incensed about, should be angry. You know, people forget that Thomas Aquinas, who I know something about, was very, very angry himself because there was no word for the virtue of anger in Latin, the language in which he wrote. He said, he or she who is not angry when there is just cause for anger sins, okay, is unjust. Why? Because anger looks to the good of justice, and if you can live among injustice or calamity coming or going, then you are unjust. So if people are angry, and I used to be a little bit ashamed of being angry because I'm Irish and it comes all too easily, well, there is just cause for anger, given all the indignities that you have just racked up here, Gary. Now, let me address briefly why Julian Assange finds himself in the situation that he is in. People, and especially young people who haven't been following this very, very long, need to have a little chronology, I think, and I'll do this very briefly. It goes sort of in three-year increments. The first was 2007, when George Bush and Dick Cheney decided to double down in Iraq in something called the Surge, that killed 1,000 U.S. servicemen, all for nothing. During that surge, there was a helicopter, an Apache helicopter attack on 12 obvious civilians in Iraq, in near Baghdad. They're all killed, and they were photographed. There was, you know, the gun sight photo, video was on, and the chatter about, you know, this terrible chatter by the crew. They were killed in cold blood. Chelsea Manning, then just Manning, saw that film, and he said, you know, this is the final straw. I see all the injustice that's going on here. I'm going to give this to somebody. It wound up with Julian Assange through secret channels, protected channels, and he ran it. That was called collateral murder. You can see 12 people, 12 Iraqi civilians, two people from Reuters, all killed on the spot by this Apache helicopter with the pilot and the others gloating about it. Now, that hit the news, but very, very briefly. It hit the news because of what Chelsea Manning did. Now, before I forget to tell you, where is Chelsea Manning right now? Where is Julian Assange right now? They're both in prison, okay? Still in prison. Now, what happened? There was a Washington Post reporter with that same unit that did all this, and he saw the videotape. And what did he do? Well, he made the tar baby in Uncle Remus. He didn't say nothing. He didn't write nothing. He kept his silence. And won a big award for a book he wrote about the same unit, calling them all heroes. That's so bad it is. So that's how it started all off. Then, in 2013, Ed Snowden, who used to work with the NSA and the CIA, revealed secrets that actually showed the head of National Intelligence, James Clapper, to be a liar. Clapper had testified under oath that the U.S. does not monitor conversations of millions of Americans. That was in March of 2013. Ed Snowden revealed that that's exactly what we were doing. Then came the revelation by WikiLeaks, recipients of leaks by a CIA person, authentic CIA documents revealing tools called cyber tools, which allowed, among other things, the CIA to hack into a given server or a bunch of computers, disguise who hacked in, and leave telltale signs like, they worked in Chinese, Korean, Persian, Arabic, and Russian. So these little Cyrillic telltale signs were capable of being inserted in these networks, falsely attributing to the people who spoke that language. Now, I'll fast forward here because we're running out of time, but I would say that the New York Times kept silence on this incredible revelation. It was made on March 31st, 2017. Why do I remember that? Well, what happened was I got a call early in the morning, 7 o'clock. This is RT. Oh, why are you calling me? Well, can you come into a studio right away? Because there's some big, big breaking development. I said, why? What's going on? He said, well, we'll send you the email, but can you come? I said, well, let me see the email first. When I looked at the email, I said, whoa, it was this Vault 7 disclosures, one of the tools of which I have just described. And it was quite alarming, and nobody else was publishing it just yet. So I said, well, how soon do you need? Well, wait a second, you don't open until about 11 o'clock. No, you can use the Eurovision studio, K Street. So I got in my car, and I'm driving in a carpool lane to get in there on time. And I thought, well, maybe I ought to call Bill Binney, who used to be technical director of NSA, to find out what this is all about. So I said, Bill, have you seen this? He says, yes. He says, look, Ray, this is how you should look at this. There are 700 million lines of code in this program, okay, Vault 7. Now, I said, Bill, that sounds like a lot. Hey, look, Ray, I know you're a history major, but that is a lot. Think of it this way, Ray. Each line of code costs $25. Can you still do multiplication? I said, yeah. He said, this operation between NSA and CIA started while I was still at NSA, says Bill. Look at it this way. He says, it gives them the capability to do all kinds of crazy things, including hacking into systems and blaming it on other people. So tell them that. So that's what I told RT, and the one other Sputnik asked me to talk later that day. There was no interest in the mainstream media, even though Ellen Nakashima didn't get the memo about not publishing this. She published a very good article, actually, in the Washington Post, which indicated, among other things, that that tool, that hacking tool, had been used during 2016. So just think about used during 2016. Now, when that was all going on, Julian Assange, before he released the really damning report on 31st of March 2017, he said, look, I have all this stuff. I have already described it as more volatile and more damaging to the U.S. reputation and CIA's than all the material that Ed Snowden brought out into Hong Kong. Now, let's make a deal. I will tell you who it wasn't that hacked into the DNC because I know, okay? I don't reveal my sources, but I can tell you with technical proof who didn't hack into the DNC. A deal, and for which you give me some limited freedom, let me come out of the embassy. And that deal was almost completed when James Comey learned about it, put the kibosh on it, said, cease these negotiations, and that was the end of that. So what happened then? Of course, Assange was kept pretty much incommunicado for the next year. And after that, on April 11th, 2019, he was dragged unceremoniously out of the Ecuadorian embassy, and he ended up in a Mexican security prison where he is being tortured. There's no doubt about that. He's being tortured, and the UN Rapporteur for Torture has written an incredibly good op-ed indicating how he came from a non-believer in Julian Assange, how he tracked down all the charges against him, and now considers him a tortured hero. What's the U.S. game plan? They want to kill him before he has to be extradited. Why? Because he knows who hacked into the DNC, and it wasn't the Russians. Why? Because he has spilled out all these other secrets and could yet spill out some more. Why? Because they hate him. They hate him from the collateral murder video, and therefore encouraging other people to find secure ways to leak this information to people who have the courage of Assange and the technical means to make it available to the rest of us so that we know what's going on. It's a very, very sad day for the media, because they are hardly jumping to Assange's aid or defense. And there, too, I would say the handwriting is on the wall. They've come for Assange. They've come for Chelsea Manning. Now they've come for Max Blumenthal. Look that one up on your email. He's been in prison. He was in prison for 2 days. For what? For nothing. So they'll come for us sooner or later, unless we, as you encourage us to do, wake up out of our stupor and realize that we're very stupid if we don't mount the equivalence of a revolution whereby we can stick it to the powers that be and say, we're going to be a real democracy now. We're going to speak in favor of the freedom of the press, and of course, we're going to do what we can to attenuate the effects of global warming.
Ray, I appreciate that overview. Would you please make yourself available tonight at 7 p.m. Eastern Time so we can go into greater depth on why they're going after Max Blumenthal, why the left attacked Glenn Greenwald and other progressive journalists who weren't willing to get on the Russian bandwagon, where we're looking for the truth and what they were doing, why you and all the other whistleblowers and people who had worked within the intelligence community were right and can prove it, yet no one from the New York Times or Washington Post will dare tell the truth that it was not possible for the Russians to have done what Hillary Clinton stated. So we can look, and by the way, I said all along that Hillary Clinton was laying in wait to come back in, and now she is going to be coming back in, probably with John Kerry as a running mate. So we need to go deeper into this, and I'd like a full hour to discuss this if you'll make yourself available.
I'd be happy to do that. What time did you say?
7 p.m. on the Progressive Commentary Hour. And by the way, the Progressive Commentary Hour, this kicks because this is a program every week where we only take on the most hard-hitting topics in depth with the conversations with remarkable minds. That's where people can hear that. So I'll look forward to sharing that with you tonight at 7 p.m.
Thank you. Sounds great.
So that is that's just an opening preview of what we're going to be getting into in greater depth of why we are in trouble, and we best pay attention to how the centrists, which are really the fascistic wing of the Democratic Party and all those involved, how they've been manipulating, controlling the media, controlling the narrative, and not doing a damn thing to make us better. One quick mention before we sign off, and hopefully you all tune in to PRN.FM at 7 p.m. The wonderful BAI, for all of its flaws, is still a very important and powerful voice for the local communities of New York City. And for hard-hitting investigative reporting and other issues you will not hear on the other media. But it's under siege by a small group, and they've shut it out. It's in the court system now. I'm hopeful that the courts will rule, the state court will rule, that what they did was not right and return BAI to the airwaves. But BAI may not survive because of all of the people who have gone all over to other places, because when you're off the air for a month, people simply stop listening. They might get, they'll be lucky to get 10% of their audience back, which means that would be a death knell. Maybe that was what was intended. In any case, I have asked Jesse at the Progressive Radio Network to keep some spots open from 5 in the morning till 9 in the morning, from 6 in the evening till midnight. You know, a total of 8 hours almost of really good broadcasting time, so that if any of the people who wish to continue on air will at least have a place to do so on PRN. However, we are, if you were only in Jesse's shoes and see how many different radio programs and people around the world want to be on the show, you couldn't believe it. So that window closes tonight at 6 o'clock. So if you get the message out, please get the message out to other people who are on BAI. You got till tonight to call Jesse at 646-926-5429. 646-926-5429. That's his direct lot dial number if you want to be considered to have a place on Progressive Radio Network. Thank you all for listening. I'll see you tonight at 7 o'clock. Have a nice day.